Hello everyone! After learning how does a real number line looks like, or what should be done to recreate or revisit what a real number line looks like, it's now our task to slowly plot different real numbers on the real number line. Okay? But before we could actually plot specific values of real numbers on a real number line, we need to master the concept of arranging the real numbers first. So in identifying which real number came first or which real number is to the left or the of the other or to the right of the other, as soon as we are done with that, it's now easier for us to plot those real numbers. But there are two different arrangements of real numbers. It could be in ascending order or descending order. Ascending order means the first value that comes, the first value that is written first is the least, has the least value, and the last number to be written has the greatest value. For the descending order, it's the other way around. To illustrate that further, let me give you three different sets of numbers to arrange, to be arranged on a real number line. Okay, so I have given you here three different numbers for practice exercise B, specifically on arranging these real numbers. But I have also specified here what type of arrangement we need to establish. Do not worry, this is just an additional analysis for all of us. But definitely, in a real number line, what number is written in your left, or which number is written in your left, has the lesser value than what is written to your right. Okay? But first, let us consider number one. Number one has the real numbers 3, 0, square root of 3, 3/4, and 1/2. To determine which number is to be written to the left, we need to determine which value is the least here. Okay? Take note that in the four numbers here, okay, all of them except for one are positive. In short, that number that is non-positive is the lesser value. That is actually zero. Okay. In short, zero has the least value for this group. Okay. So let us try to determine now the relationship of each. How do we determine that? We know that for the first pair of numbers, let's consider it pair by pair. First pair of numbers, let me use the color red. We know that 0 is less than 3. Or you could actually say 3 is greater than 0. Being established that, establishing that means that 3 should be written to the right of 0. Or 0 should be written to the left of 3. So we have now established the first partner in a real number line. Okay? 0 should be written here to the left of 3. Let's consider the next values. How about square root of 3? Now, this is where estimating of irrational number is very important. You may view the other video concerned mainly on estimating irrational numbers to determine practice how to get the value of square root of 3. But let me just give you a small input here. Right? Square root of 3, we are looking for the principal square root of 3. Okay? In short, we are going to look at the values of the perfect square numbers. That's the opposite of principal square root. So the perfect square numbers are 1, 4, 9, 16, 25. As to how do we get these perfect square numbers, you could again visit the other video. But again, the perfect square numbers are the results when you multiply the number to itself. Let's say 1 times 1, you have 1. 2 times 2, you have 4. 3 times 3, you have 9. 4 times 4 is 16, and 5 times 5 is 25. We are going to use these values to determine where do we see square root of 3. Square root of 3, or let's take a look at the value to which we are looking for the principal root of 4. 3 is between 1 and 4. Okay? In short, 3 is the perfect square number. So if 3 is between 1 and 4, the value of the square root of 3 is just between the square root of 1, which is 1, and the square root of 4, which is 2. In short, the value for the principal root of square root of 3 is between 1 to 4. Again, to discuss this better, you could check the other videos, specifically on irrational numbers. Now that we have determined that square root of 3 is just between 1 and 2, and we have this first relationship, this means that square root of 3 is greater than 0. Okay? Because 1 or 2 or any value in between 1 and 2 is greater than 0. Another thing, any of this value, 1 or 2 or anything in between, are all less than 3. In short, the value for square root of 3 is also less than 3. So we have now established 3 different numbers. Let's look at the next numbers. 3/4. I usually say I would prefer to see numbers in fractional forms other than numbers in decimal notation. But for topic like this, wherein we are rearranging the items or the real numbers, it would be best if we could get the specific equivalence of the fractions. 3/4 is equivalent to 0.75. Okay, so 0.75. Where do we locate 3/4 here? Now, we know that square root of 3 is just between 1 to 2. 0.75 is lesser than any of the values here. So we could say that 0.75 or 3/4 is greater than 0, but it's less than square root of 3, which is also less than 3. Why are we doing this? We are doing this so that we could establish later on their relationships. Let me take this first. Take this out. Okay. So we could have more spaces. Last number, 1/2. 1/2 is just 0.5 or 5/10. So 0.5/10 is lesser than 0.75, which is 3/4, but still greater than 0. In short, we can say that it's greater than 1/2 is greater than 0, which is also less than 3/4, and less than square root of 3, and less than 3. So we have now established the relationships of the 5 numbers. Let us now go to the intended arrangement, ascending. Ascending means what number is written first has the least value, and what number that is written last has the greater value. This is already in our ascending order, with 0 as the lesser value and 3 as the greatest value, or that 0 is the least value and 3 has the greatest value. So to arrange this, we can remove the symbols for inequality here and just simply say for number 1, you have 0, comma 1/2, comma 3/4, comma square root of 3, and you have 3. This is the answer for item number 1. Okay. This is the arrangement of the first set of numbers in ascending order. Let's go to number 2. But first, let me add some spaces here. Let me add some spaces so we could actually scribble down more items. So let's have number 2 here. Number 2, let me increase first the font size. There is something for a while. Okay. Let us increase it to 36. Okay. Number 2. In number 2, we are given with these values here, but we are now tasked to give a descending order. My suggestion, do not be worried first on what intended arrangement you are tasked to, First, arrange or determine the relationships with different numbers. Definitely, we all know that 0 is less than any positive numbers, but 0 is still greater than any negative numbers. Okay? Ones that down and there are negative numbers, it's always less than 0. Okay? So let's pick here first what are the positive numbers and the negative numbers. So you have here square root of 5 as a positive number. And you have here 3/5 as a positive number. Since they are both positive, we are now assured that they are both of them are greater than 0. On the other hand, we have negative 1/2 here, and you have negative 1. And we are assured, since they are both negatives, we are assured that the values of these two real numbers are less than 0. So we have now established this relationship. The next thing is to simply look at the relationship of these two and the other two here. Let's look at the values for the negative side. So you have negative 1 and negative 1/2, which could also be written as negative 0.50. Take note that when you go to your left or to the left of the real numbers or the negative numbers towards negative infinity, as it goes farther from 0, the value of the negative increases. But the value of the number decreases. Okay. What do you mean by the value of the negative increases? You mean negative 10, you have negative 20, the negative 30. So it increases its negativity, but the value decreases. The smaller the bigger the negativity, the smaller the value. So when you're going to arrange this, negative 1 is bigger or has bigger negativity than negative 1/2. In short, in terms of value, negative 1 is less than negative 1/2. So we could say that negative 1 is less than negative 1/2 or negative 0.5. And then we can simply add here greater than 0. Because again, 0 is always greater than any negative number. Next, for the next positive, the other side, 3/5 can be written in decimal notation as 6/10 or 0.60. As to how, you could actually just simply look at the relationship of 3/5. You can increase this into 100, meaning you multiply it this to 20. Actually, this is already covered in your elementary years. And you also multiply this to 20. So you have 60 over 100. Or in short, 60/10. Or you can cancel that out, sorry. You can say 6/10. So that's 6/10 or 0.60. But square root of 5, we don't know what is that. So let's go back again to the range of perfect square numbers because it's square root. The perfect square numbers, again, you have 1, 4, 9, 16, 25. 5 is located here. Let me use another color. 5 is located here. So the 5 is not a square root, perfect square, no, 5 is not a perfect square number. It's just between the perfect square numbers 4 and 9. In short, the value for square root of 5 is between the square root of 4, principal square root of 4, which is 2, and the principal square root of 9, which is a 3. In short, it's between 2, 3. So square root of 5 has value of 2, 3. And we're going to compare value of square root of 5. We don't actually need to look for the estimated value of it in nearest hundreds. Just simply look at the difference. Okay. This is 0.60. This is even lesser than 2. So we could assume that 0.60 is less than, let's not use 0.60. 0.60, which is 3/5, is less than square root of 5. If that is the case, we can just simply combine it to make a general statement for all values. Okay. So this is now the relationship that we have made. Now that we are done with comparing all these 5 numbers, let's go back to the intended arrangement. The intended arrangement is in descending order. This is different from ascending order. Descending order means the number that we should be written first has the greatest value, and the number that should be written last is the has the least value. In this case, the greatest value is square root of 5. So our answer should be square root of 5, comma, followed by 3/5, followed with 0, negative 1/2, and then you have your negative 1. So this is now the coverage for number 2 in descending order. To continue, we still have number 3. But in number 3, take note that there is now a presence of a principal square root and a principal cube root. We have now principal square root and principal cube root. So let's arrange them properly. Again, any numbers, any negative numbers are all less than the positive numbers. So to determine there's no zero here, we can say that square root, I have multiple of 3s here. This means that negative square root of 2, you have negative 4/3, and then you have negative 1. All of these values are less than cube root of 6 and 9/5. Cube root of 6 and 9/5. Okay. So we are now sure that these two are greater than the rest here. So we could just simply look at the relationship of these three numbers and the relationship of these two numbers, and we can determine the relationship of all. Now, negative 1, and let's pair first negative 1 and negative 4/3. Negative 4/3 is actually equivalent to a mixed number. Again, I don't usually allow you to use mixed number, but it's, yes, equivalent to negative 1 and 1/3, which has the greater negativity as comparison to negative 1. In short, the value of negative 4/3 is lesser than negative 1. So you have here negative 4/3 is lesser than negative 1. How about negative square root of 2? This is now estimation comes in. All right. So let us again increase the space to this side. Let me reduce this first. Like that. Okay. So let us try to determine what is the value of negative square root of 2. Negative square root of 2 is still in square root. So you have here 1, the value is 1. I'm just copying here just perfect square numbers, and 25. 2 is somewhere here. It's between the perfect squares of 1 and 4. In short, the square root of 2, okay, the square root of 2, let's leave muna the negative outside. The square root of 2 is between the square root of 1, which is 1, and the square root of 4, which is 2. So it's between 1 to 2. But since we have negative here outside, so the square root of the negative square root of 2 is between negative 1 to negative 2. We are going to use the proper arrangement of these two numbers. So it's actually interchange to negative 2 to negative 1. So it's just between negative 2 to negative 1. Okay? It's between negative 2 to negative 1. But here, in this value here, negative 4/3 is still negative 2 to negative 1. Okay? So we are not yet sure whether negative square root of 2 is bigger or smaller, or has the bigger value or smaller value to negative 4/3. What we need to do now is to proceed to the next estimation, the nearest tenths. Take note that negative 1 and 1/3 in decimal notation is negative 1.333. It doesn't end, so you may use bar here. Okay, so it's 1.3 something, and then you simply place a bar that determines it doesn't end. Okay. So let us try to determine what is square root of 2, negative square root of 2. Again, let's take first the square root of 2. Since it's between 1 to 2, the positive muna. Let's take the positive. It's been between 1 to 2. Where is it closer to? Again, to help you with this, you can look at the separate video on estimating irrational numbers. 2 is closer to 1 than to 4. Because you just simply need here one step, and you need here two steps. So in short, the nearest tenths of this is 1 than 2. Or in terms of negative number, it's closer to negative 1 than negative 2. And since we are looking for the nearest tenths, so let's look at the values nearer to negative 1 than negative 2 in tenths. Our values in tenths. So you have here -1, -1.2, -1.3. Okay. But again, I mentioned earlier, let's just use the positive values first because we are isolating the negative here. So it's between 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, 1.4, and 1.5. To estimate further, we can just simply square this, right? Or multiply all numbers to itself. Okay. This may take longer than the previous numbers because we have here values which are very close to each other. So we have 1.1 times 1.1 and then so on and so forth. This is actually 1.21. This is 1.44. This is 1.69. And you have here 1.96 and you have 2.25. The value of 2, again, if you are in confusion, you may check the video on estimating irrational numbers. But since it's part here, I'm going to discuss it still. So 2 is closer to 1.96 because it only needs 0.04 step than 2.25, which needs 0.25 steps. In short, the value for square root of 2, the positive square root of 2, is approximately in tenths 1.4. It's closer to this value here, the square root of 1.4. So for the negative square root of 2, it is closer to negative 1.4. Since we know that for negative 4 tenths is negative 1.333, so on and so forth, we know that whatever the value here, whether it's 0, whether it's 1, whether it's 2, this is still lesser than this. So we could say that this is actually still lesser than square root of 2 because the value for the negative square root of 2 is approximately negative 1.4 and this is 1.3 something. Now, we have established the relationships of the three different negative numbers. And we all know that any of these are less than the values here. But we have here another irrational number. So we are going to proceed with the same situation. 9.5 first is actually in decimal notation 1.8. Let's look at cube root of 6. So again, let me increase here the space at the bottom. Okay. So you have cube root of 6. Since it's cube root, we are going to look at the perfect cube numbers. So you have 1. The cube of 1 is 1. The cube of 2 is 8. The cube of 3 is 27. Or you can continue. But since we're looking for 6, it's already here. 6 is between the perfect cubes of 1 and 8. In short, it is between the value of the cube root of 6 is between cube root of 1, which is 1, and cube root of 8, which is 2. So it's between 1 to 2. But it's not yet clear when we are just simply going to use this, because we know that 1.8 here as a value for 9/5 is still between 1 to 2. The next is to estimate in the nearest tenths. To answer that, let us determine where is 6 closest to, or closer to. From 6 to 1, you need 5 steps. From 6 to 8, you need 2 steps. So the value of 6 is closer to the perfect cube of 2, which is 8. So the cube root of 6 is closer to the cube root of 8, which is 2. As to the nearest integer. But then again, we don't know as of the moment which is smaller, because this is also closer to 2 than to 1. So we proceed to the nearest tenths. Since it's closer to 2 than to 1, so we are going to use the values in decimal notation in tenths closest to 2, which are 1.5, 1.6, 1.7, 1.8, 1.9. We may use 2, but again, it's not equal to 2. It's just closer to 2. So we just settle with this. And then we multiply these numbers itself. But since we are in cube root, we will be using 3 different numbers of this, and you multiply them to each other, and then what are the values here? So we are going to multiply the different values in cube form. Okay, so we have here for the first number, you have 3.375, and you have 1.6, you have 4.096. Sorry, it's not, it's point. It's not comma. And then you have 1.7, which is 4.913. And then you have here 1.8, which is 5.832. And finally, you have 1.9, which is 6.859. So let's look at 6. Where do we see 6 here? From here to there. And here to here, we need to determine where is it closer to determine the nearest tenths. So it's closer to, okay, let's look at here. From 6 to 5.832, it needs 0.168 steps. For the other side, yeah, it needs 0.859 steps. In short, it's closer to the value of 5.832, which is the perfect cube of 1.8. So cube root of 6 is now better than 2. It's closer to 1.8. However, the value of 9.5 is still 1.8. Yes, you know what to do. Instead of settling down here, we need to look at the nearest hundreds. As to the nearest hundreds, since we know that it's between 1.8 and 1.9, but it's closer to 1.8 than 1.9, so we use the values of 1.81, 1.82, 1.83, 1.84, and 1.85. As you can see, we are on the real number line, but we are still going back to estimation of irrational numbers. So we have here these items here. Okay. And then multiply them. Okay. in mathematics, as I have stated before, you don't need to rush. Take it slowly. And you can also use your calculators if you want to. But of course, during assessments, we are hoping that you will also try to answer them on your own first. So the first item is equal to 5.929, then 741. And the next, 1.82 times 1.82 times 1.82 is actually 6.028568. You may proceed with the next if you want. But since we're looking for the value where 6 belongs or falls to, it's already here. 6 is already here. Okay? So 6 is closer to which group? From 6 to this value, you need 0.07026. So 5.9. Okay. And then from here to there, you need 0.028568. Okay. You may correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. I would be very happy if you will correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. So where is it really closer to, 1.81 or 1.82? Just need to determine where is it closer to, right? So between the two, it is now closer to this area here because this is smaller than that. Let's take out 0.02 and 0.7. So the value of the cube root of 6 in nearest hundredths is closer to 1.82. We can just simply settle here now because it's very, very clear now that 1.82 and here is 1.8. So in terms of the value 1.8, 1.82, we know that 9/5 is smaller than the cube root of 6. So this is just what we need to do earlier. This is the value here. This is the relationship of the 5 items, but we touch the topic of estimating irrational numbers. But wait, are we now good? Not yet. Let's go to the intended arrangement. The intended arrangement is descending, similar to number 2. So we are going to write here the number with the largest value first, cube root of 6, and then 9/5, and then negative 1, -4/3. We are using commas, sorry. And then finally, -√2. This is the answer for number 3. Whew, it's very long, but those things are needed here for us to determine the proper arrangement. So this is how we rearrange items or real numbers before we could plot them in the real number line. Because the purpose for this is, as we plot them on the real number line, we know which value is on the left of the other or on the right of the other. As we have mentioned before, yes, this would take long, but in mathematics, there's no need to rush. Okay? Hopefully you have learned something. Please use this video as you prepare in plotting these values in the real number line. That's for the next video. Thank you very much and have a nice day.